would like to thank Professor Zohar Goshen for extending me an invitation to participate in this conference. Holding conferences like this give experts and practitioners an important forum for collaboration. Unfortunately, I will not be able to stay and enjoy the entire conference with you, but I saw the schedule for today, and it is sure to be a fascinating program regarding corporate law and governance. Delaware is known as a jurisdiction of choice for incorporation in the U.S. One of the reasons for this is the Delaware Court, which is known worldwide for its expertise in corporate law. The Delaware Court of Chancery is a specialized court with specific jurisdiction over corporate disputes. Cases from the Court of the Chancery can be appealed to the Delaware Supreme Court, where the five justices of corporate law experts, one of the distinguished justices of the court, Justice Seitz, is here with us today, and we're very honored to have you. Delaware corporate law, both statutory and common law, guides courts dealing with corporate law issues, both in the U.S. and other countries. Delaware law has also had a significant impact on the development of the Israeli corporate law. As I will further demonstrate, Israeli courts tend to examine and draw inspiration from the Delaware law when dealing with complex corporate law issues. The influence of the Delaware corporate law in various countries is particularly strong given the effect that globalization has had on international trade and the global economy. Indeed, legal globalization in these areas and the effect it has on legal issues encourages the courts, legal scholars, and practitioners to turn to comparative law. Courts' reliance on foreign law raises questions regarding the role of comparative law in judicial decisions. Today, I would like to focus on the use of comparative law in general, and specifically its use in the area of corporate law. The use of comparative law by courts around the world is common. However, there are different approaches regarding the role of comparative law in judicial decisions. A radical negative approach was presented by several justices and academics in the U.S., such as Judge Posner, Justice Scalia, the late Justice Scalia, and former Chief Justice of the U.S., Justice Rehnquist. Some believe that referring to foreign law in constitutional analysis is anti-democratic, as it overextends judicial discretion and undermines the decision made by the democratically elected representative of the people. Judge Richard Posner has expressed his view to that effect, saying that, quote, the problem is not learning from abroad. It is treating foreign judicial decisions as authorities in USA cases as if the world were a single legal community. In Lawrence versus Texas case of 2003, which dealt with the validity of a Texas statute making it a crime for two persons of the same sex to engage in certain intimate sexual conduct, the Supreme Court of the United States discussed the different approaches to the use of comparative law. Justice Scalia rejected the reliance on the values of other nations and preferred relying solely on American values, tradition, and history, stating that discussion of foreign views is meaningless dicta and even dangerous dicta to his mind. A similar approach was taken by then Chief Justice Rehnquist, as I said, who completely dismissed the use of comparative law in his dissent in the Atkins versus Virginia of 2002, which dealt with the constitutionality of the death penalty in cases where people with mental disabilities were convicted of murder. On the other hand, there is a more positive approach regarding the use of comparative law, even among some justices on the US Supreme Court. In struck contrast to Chief Justice Rehnquist, Justice Scalia, and Judge Posner, Justices Bader Ginsburg, Kennedy, and Breyer have more readily accepted the use of foreign law as a judicial tool. Justice Breyer has even said that, quote, judgment of other nations should help guide this court. In Lawrence versus Texas, which I mentioned earlier, Justice Kennedy cited foreign sources such as the European Court of Human Rights and the laws of other nations and pointed to the values shared with, quote, a wider civilization. Such a positive approach towards comparative law can be found in other countries as well. The Commonwealth nations such as Australia, Canada, and South Africa regularly cite each other's jurisprudence. These courts do not hesitate to turn to foreign law and especially to UK law. In turn, the UK courts have also become increasingly open to the use of foreign jurisprudence. The Israeli courts take the more positive approach regarding the use of comparative law. They certainly turn to comparative law, and as former president of the court, Aaron Barak, said, they see comparative law as, quote, an experienced friend, and as a tool with which judges fulfill their role in a democracy. There are several reasons for the positive approach, to my mind, to the positive approach towards comparative law taken by the Israeli courts. The first relates to Israel's legal history. As you may know, this land was governed by a British mandate from 1917 until 1948, when Israel declared its independence. And before that, before the British mandate, it was governed by Ottoman Empire for many years. As a result, these laws formed the foundational layers of Israeli law. In fact, Israeli law still includes some residuals of Ottoman and British influences. Another reason that Israel has taken a positive approach towards comparative law is the fact that the founding generation of the legal profession in Israel were trained abroad, especially in the UK and Germany. And third, Israel, as a young country, has smaller corpus of jurisprudence than other more established legal systems. For all of these reasons, it was and still is common for the Supreme Court of Israel to use comparative law to inform its most important decisions, especially regarding novel legal issues which have not yet been settled in Israeli law. The court will often cite higher court decisions from the US, the UK, Canada, Australia, and Germany. However, such decisions are not binding, do not have a binding effect on the court. They are examined carefully and critically to compare the characteristics of the foreign law to those of the Israeli law in order to understand their overall effect and context. Hence, foreign law can only be a source of inspiration whose use is legitimate but limited. There are legal fields in which the use of comparative law and the application of foreign law is more easily accepted, and other legal fields in which the use of comparative law is more complex. Examination of foreign law can be particularly useful when a court is dealing with constitutional issues and cites foreign laws of countries which share the same democratic and constitutional values. Indeed, Israel's constitutional law has been influenced by comparative law. Israel does not have, as you may know, does not have a complete written constitution yet. Rather, it has chapters of what is meant to be a full constitution in the future. One important chapter of the future constitution is basic law, human dignity and liberty, enacted in 1992. This basic law was inspired by the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Naturally, when the Supreme Court of Israel had to interpret this basic law, it turned to Canadian constitutional jurisprudence dealing with the Charter as a source of guidance. The use of foreign law can be more complex, as I said, when the court is dealing with other legal fields, such as corporate law, for instance. In order to cope with corporate law challenges in the dynamic business reality, it can certainly be useful for judges to turn to foreign law as a source of inspiration and take advantage of the experience of foreign courts that have dealt with the same and similar challenges. As I already mentioned, Israeli courts have often cited foreign law, especially from Delaware, deciding corporate law cases. The intercolony case is an illustrative example. In her decision, Deputy to the President, Justice Miriam Naor, as she then was, referred extensively to foreign law. This was a corporate law case which centered around the question of whether a shareholder in a company can bring a derivative action in the name of its subsidiary and or in the name of the subsidiary's subsidiary. In other words, can there be a double or a multiple derivative action? Justice Naor engaged in a comprehensive survey of foreign law on this issue. She examined the jurisprudence in various USA states, as well as British and Hong Kong. Finally, she stated that these types of actions are not exceptional and are actually commonplace. She ultimately adopted the approach whereby double and multiple derivative actions are permitted, even though it is not explicitly stated in Israeli law. The Israeli Supreme Court also turned to comparative law when faced with the issue of appraisal rights. In the Kital case, the justices turned to foreign law in deciding the appropriate method for determining the fair value of a public company's share. I was on the panel that decided the appeal in this case, and I found it important to express a reservation in that respect, saying, to the extent to which my colleagues suggest that we import the method that was used in the Delaware a few decades ago, it is important to learn from the experience accumulated there and to consider the criticism and the reservations that had emerged as a result. Unquote. The district courts in Israel and the Supreme Court also turned to American corporate law, in particular to the Delaware corporate law, as a source of inspiration when they were confronted with the question of the appropriate standard of judicial review of companies' business decisions. Israeli courts referred to different standards set out in Delaware law, such as the business judgment rule. The BJR was formally adopted by the Israeli court following a recent ruling of the Supreme Court, where Justice Amit stated that the principle of the rule are, quote, an integral part of the Israeli corporate law. However, Justice Amit emphasized that the import of the BJR into Israeli law should be carried out with the appropriate adjustments to Israeli corporate statutory law. Justice Amit's opinion reflected a keen awareness of significant differences between Delaware law and Israeli law, and loose quote in English, one must take into consideration the Delaware's corporate law regarding the approval of stakeholder transactions in different is different from Israeli corporate law. As mentioned earlier, the Delaware corporate law does not include a mechanism of pre-approval of stakeholders' transaction, as opposed to Israeli law, which has an approval mechanism. The question of the appropriate standard of judicial review of companies' business decisions was also discussed by the Tel Aviv District Court judges of the Economic Division. Judges Ronen and Kaboub, in cases involving a going private merger transaction in which the controlling shareholder purchased the shares of the minority. The court discussed whether the Delaware Supreme Court ruling in the MFW case should be applied in Israel. The district court judges did not yet determine whether it should or should not apply in Israel, and as I see, this issue will be discussed here today. Right? Judge Kaboub emphasized the relevant difference between Israeli and the Delaware court regarding this specific issue in the Klal Ta'asiyot case and stated, quote, the American law and the Delaware court's ruling are important sources of inspiration for Israeli courts. However, the differences between Delaware law and Israeli law and the differences between the American capital market and the Israeli one require extra caution before adopting legal norms set in Delaware to Israeli case laws, unquote. In conclusion, Israeli courts acknowledge the importance of international cooperation and the transfer of knowledge and will continue to be open to foreign ideas while being sensitive to the unique characteristics of Israel, its laws, history, values, and needs. With this increased dialogue and the availability of case law from all over the world, including from Delaware, I am confident that the jurisprudence in Israel will become richer. Thank you.